it's fun to do this. It's, you know, this is a chance for me to talk about music. You interviewed me for Sirius Radio, and we talked about comedy. So it's kind of the inverse of entering someone else's field. It's gonna get uncomfortable. This could get really weird and uncomfortable. But I'm excited that you guys asked me to do it because it's just fun to get to ask you questions, just for me, so I can learn things. I don't care if this helps you sell records.
We don't either. We just want this to be fun.
Exactly. Because now looking back, you guys, you know, made a choice not to chase all the press. It seems like it was like a great idea that leads to longevity, because we all watch these people on TV, and after a while, like, you just get sick of people. How do you guys look at that scale down?
A lot of it, I think, was Ed pulling back and saying, I need to, like, just recover from this situation that we just went through. And I think probably at that time, a lot of us probably would have went, this is what you're supposed to do, so let's just keep going, or else if you don't keep going, then it dies, or, you know. And I think going through that process with him and then sort of seeing the successes that kind of came out of us pulling back and kind of doing what we want to do and maybe not succeeding right away, but still kind of growing this, our sort of, our life as a band kept growing, then we really started to see the payoff of not having, like, being patient with it and just kind of going, you don't have to do anything this year. You don't have to, you know, if we don't go tour every city in the world, everything's gonna be fine. Mm-hmm.
Very few people, I think, have the courage to do that, to not chase it really hard.
And I think we started recording this record almost 2 years ago. So it's been a it's been a long process, but it's cool to want to hang out with everybody, you know, because it's not always that way.
How does it start with a record like that? Do you have any visions for what you're going to do going in, or it's just everyone sits down and says, "I've had some ideas the last year or two. Let's all share them and start picking at them."
We just book studio time. We just say we're going to book some studio time and show up, we're gonna do 3 or 4 days.
Yeah.
And you go in there and you go in at, you know, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and you just kind of start with one guy's song and you say, okay, well, what's your song? And let's hear it. And you kind of work up a version of it and you have the demo and you keep it kind of, you know, you kind of keep the demo and keep the new version and then you move on to the next guy's song, and Ed will come in and he'll hear stuff, and sometimes he'll throw what will be the basic melody and almost maybe even a lot of the words on something in 10 minutes, or sometimes he won't even hear it that first day, and it'll be, you know, a year later that all of a sudden he goes, oh, this is great. I never heard this, or this is, you know.
Is that a tense thing, the unveiling your ideas?
Absolutely.
To everybody?
It's not necessarily tense, but it's, you know, everyone's got their little babies, you know, they're like, you know. And you never know what's going to happen, and you can, you know, if you love your baby, sometimes that's the worst thing you can do. You know, you've almost got to go in ready to, like, you know, take your baby's arm off one right off the bat, and, you know, or have somebody say that your favorite part needs to only happen once, or, you know, and that's a great process, but it's not easy.
Do you have to mentally prepare yourself, like, tomorrow's the day I got to play all my stuff, and if they don't like it, I'm going to be pissed, but I'm not going to get pissed. I'm going to be cool about it. Like, are you past that already?
I mean, there is a thing that's changed for me. Like, I think I used to always think, I'm going to put the two songs that I think are definitely Pearl Jam songs at the front, and I do exactly the opposite now. I put the songs that I think have the most potential at the end and put the weird song at the front. And you just never know. Like, somebody will go like, wow, that's awesome. You'd be like, really?
And it's never over in the day. The day you unveil your song, there's not this moment where it's either going to happen, or it might be over that day. You know what I mean? It might be, the reaction might be so like, oh, this is, you know, what else you got? If you have a song that you want to demo up, everyone will demo up something with you, and then you never know. You know, 2 weeks later, somebody said, oh, that's cool. I've been listening to the demos, and, you know, I really like that one. And
sounds like a comedy writer's room, like when you work for a sitcom. Yeah. There's a head writer, and everybody pitches jokes. And what most head writers do is, if they don't want to take your joke, they just don't acknowledge you spoke. Right. You're like, what if he said this? And then you just see the guy, like, eating his M&Ms, and he just doesn't even turn to you.
Silence occurs. Silence for sure occurs.
And is there a sense of patience about it, that, oh, this might take 2 years, or going in, it could take 3 months, it could take 2 years, and everyone's in just some sort of flexible headspace about it?
This last record, I think we expected to kind of go down, work on it for a few months, work on another few months, and basically be done with it. That's been our process, you know, and this is the first one where we really worked on about half of it, got about what we realized was about half done, and then a lot of stuff kind of came up, and we did a lot of stuff, and then realized to finish it, we still needed another half of a record, and it was almost like two whole, it was almost a little bit of making two records.
Does it feel like the beginning of a new era now? Like, is there any sense of that? Or, you know, it's funny because when you go back and read articles about the band, there's all these different points where they talk about it like a new era, but like seven times. So, like, what does it feel like to you guys, like, where you're at this moment?
I think that's a rock and roll cliche, is every time you make a record, you like come out and go, okay, this is, you know, I feel like this awakening in us, and it's, there's, everybody really understands each other now, and we're all just, it's more of the same. We're digging in with each other, and we're, you know, feeling our way through. But I mean, I think the fact that we've been a band now for this long, all of us have a certain amount of comfort in, like, we know that there's these ups and downs and all this stuff that goes along with being a band, and that you can kind of get through it. So I think we're confident in what we're doing. I think we're probably more confident than ever, in a way.
And I think a lot of times when we make music together, there's, you feel that potential in the room, you know, when you're working up a song. And so I think in everybody's mind, you think, like, this is going to be the greatest thing that we've ever done. And I think you just try to get that feeling. You just try to feel that and feel like we still have yet to write our greatest song together and perform our greatest song together. And I, you know, there's definitely been moments of that on this record where it's like, wow, we're onto something here. Like something, you know, that's us and unique, and everybody's contributing something really special to the song, and the lyrics are great. And
what are the highlights on the new record for you guys?
Father Son, I think, is probably one of my favorites, just in terms of his cadence on that song. His Ed's singing is just like taking Jeff's riff and just going, pulling against it in a way that's just like, it just, it's very, it sounds very original to me, and it's loaded, you know, it's just really, and it's groovy, and it's heavy, and it's got these, and it's very straightforward in a way too. There's no keyboards on that one. I don't think there's any sort of, there's no, you know, studio magic other than just
two basses.
Yeah, double bass. Yeah. Our first double bass song. Mike McCready's on the 6-string bass on that one. And then just listening, I think Sirens is something pretty special too, as far as just the depth of that one. Just feels real. It feels like a kind of a classic for us.
It seems like there's several songs about holding onto your relationship and trying to be good to the person you're in a relationship with. Is it, how does it change just the whole idea of touring and what you guys do, that there are so many relationships and kids to be dealt with? I know, like, when I'm making a movie, there's, you know, an instant discussion of, where are we doing it? I'm not going to Shreveport, Louisiana. So how do you guys, you know, plan for the, you know, the world assault for the record now that there's more people involved?
Well, I think we've sort of kind of honed it down to doing 3-week legs. And I think, you know, if our significant others don't want to come out, then you're only gone for 3 weeks, and then you're kind of guaranteed to be home for 3 weeks, which is...
We don't take on that much, even when we're in our let's conquer the world mode. We're still
gonna,
like,
conquer the world for 3 solid weeks. And we might do it one more time.
That's right. I mean, every time it's, and we've been doing that for a while, and that's sane for us just as individuals, and it's sane for our families too.
When you guys are in recording mode, how collaborative is it on the lyric side? Do you guys ever read the lyrics and just go like, no. I don't know what you're talking about here. Like, is there a collaboration?
No, we don't ever do that.
You back off of that side of it. I don't know what, I disagree with you politically. I'm for wiretapping. I don't know why you're against it. But how does that,
you know what, though? He has said to me the last couple of records, like, if there's ever anything that you think is awful, tell me. You have to tell me.
Yeah.
And there was a couple of things in this thing. I was like, if I was going to lose a line, you maybe lose that one. He's like, always, you know, he's so open to that. But he's so good at it. It's really, even if I'm not 100% like there with his perspective, I always go like, wow, that's poetry.
We've all written lyrics for this band over the course of the years, but it just seems that as the records, the longer we go on now, and there's only, you know, you're gonna put a record that's gonna like be 10 songs, it's kind of hard to say, you know, I don't want you to write, I want to write a lyric, and it's just, he's on a tear right now.
Yeah.
He's got a lot of words, I think, you know, you kind of want him writing as many as he wants.
Did you guys want to talk a little bit about Getaway?
Sure.
All I got on that.
The key to that song is the bass line, because it ends up being sort of the vocal melody. So I think once Jeff, the guitar part was kind of, here's how it goes. And then I think once Jeff wrote that bass line, then all of a sudden the song sort of got a whole another shot in the arm, because it sort of inspired that vocal melody's pretty sing-songy and it's a pretty cool approach. Again, another one of those ones where he really seems to be going against the grain of the song, you know, really pushing the words out away from the sinking too much into the rest of it, you know?
It seems like Mind Your Manners is like that also.
Yeah.
Talk about Brendan O'Brien and working with him again on this and what he brings to your process. You guys have been collaborating with him for so long.
He's the mad scientist, man. We met him 20 years ago. Is that when we made Versus 20 years ago?
Yep.
And his energy has sort of gotten more and more, like he's kind of honed his craft to a point to where he has a system. Mm-hmm. And when we go into that system, it's like, it's kind of game on. It's like taking a high-end college course that's only 10 days long.
Yeah.
There's not a second that's not where he's not going through what we're going to go through, fixing what that is, and then moving on to whatever the next thing is, and almost ADD-ish sort of tenacity, you know, in terms of really, and being able to form opinions immediately. There's no, I'm not sure about this, or if I'm not sure about it, it means it's not good and we need to do something different. And if it's good, then we're through it and he's got it done and we're moving on.
When you started this record, did you have an idea going in, or is it something that just evolves once you guys start working? Do you have like any thematic ideas, or do you realize like, oh, the notes in my book are on certain issues, or that just happens?
Yeah, no, I look forward to trying it that way. Mm-hmm. I've never done it that way up to this point. It seems like it's all kind of whatever the music is dictates what it is. Especially, you know, if I'm writing the piece, then I can kind of form it to what starts percolating and whatever. But the working with the fellas, it seems, you know, whatever they bring, it'll just kind of say, okay, what, that's really what you're listening for. It's like, what does this mean? Like, what is this? What are these sounds, or what is this rhythm or momentum of it? What does it kind of dictate? And I think the faster songs are easier, and because it seems, you know, modern day, there's plenty of aggressive stuff to write about.
Yeah.
But, and then maybe the more atmospheric stuff comes, you know, real quick, because that just seems like a easy place to connect with, you know, or those are kind of things in my wheelhouse. It's the stuff that's kind of in the middle. You're not really sure what it is. And those ones become a little more of a crossword puzzle, trying to line everything up and then have it, you know, really create a meaning for, like, you know, a story or something that relates to the sound of the song, you know.
Are you writing ideas actively, or just the song is the beginning of your process in writing lyrics?
It's pretty much the beginning, like I said, I should do that more. You know, I should come in with some kind of ammunition, I think. But usually it's just something that connects all at once, you know. I'm probably pretty spoiled, or I take advantage of the fact, or I mean, I certainly respect the process, but I just kind of know that if I get in a certain space, that just something usually lands on my shoulder, you know, and then it's just a matter of like, you know, just waiting and then like, you know, waiting and then getting it down. And you can kind of manifest it to yourself and just really, and in that way, I think it's more like bricklaying or sitting at the typewriter and just doing things and then you see what happens the next morning.
I think my whole process is wrong. I'm just stressed all day long trying to think of things, but I can see why just as a lifestyle, the idea of that your inspiration begins then, as opposed to like, I'm usually just 24 hours a day thinking, why aren't you thinking of anything? Why aren't you thinking of anything? You're behind, you need to get it going.
Yeah.
Who's been most helpful to you, like among your heroes in talking about this kind of approach to the music and to a long career?
I feel like I've been learning from everybody, and you know, the other night I got to sit with Tom Petty for a little bit, and then, you know, there's Bruce and Neil and Pete and Roger and Kim and Thurston, and you know, it's all, you know, in a way you're so fortunate because you're working in something where it's a bit of a craft or whatever, but it's an endless learning cycle, and even just the instrument itself or moving to another instrument or something, you know, it's just endless.
Yeah.
And you're just still fascinated by it, and you're certainly still fascinated by these people, so. Mm-hmm.
What age did you find Quadrophenia? Like, for me, that was the big record. I've heard that was one of the records that was the mind blower.
Yeah. It's probably about 13, 14.
Yeah.
It, for some reason, I just didn't feel like there's anybody I could relate to on the whole planet. You know, nobody at school and certainly no one in the household.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it was like some guy from London named Pete. And he was like, he knew everything. And all kinds of stuff was happening in my life. So it was really just like a, you know, it was like a big, like the bridge with the planks covering a big deep chasm and the planks were just falling.
Yeah.
And it was just like, that whole period was just hanging on.
Because I feel like I had the exact same Quadrophenia experience. Because my parents broke up in between 8th and 9th grade and had like a crazy divorce. They didn't actually even get fully divorced till I was in college. They fought. And they both bankrupted each other, just fighting with lawyers and fighting. And for some reason, Quadrophenia, even now I try to think, like, what was it about Quadrophenia that made me feel a little better? Part of it was that song, I'm the One, which we used on Freaks and Geeks, because it was just exactly how I felt.
Yeah.
Like, how am I gonna get noticed? Why am I being treated so badly? Why am I invisible at school?
Yeah.
But I wasn't conscious to it for decades, like what it meant to me. Was that the main record that you had that experience with?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there was a number of things, I was finding messages in, like, you know, Split Ends and Talking Heads, and I didn't find like the band X and things like that until a little bit later, but even Empty Glass and all those things. But really, as a whole, Quadrophenia was the one that if it weren't for that, it was like, you know, thank God the record store prescribed that drug, because that's what, you know, got me through that. And even though Quadrophenia didn't really offer any answers in the end, it was really just knowing that you weren't the only one going through it.
Yeah. I feel like there's like a parallel between people who become comedians and people who get into music, because when I was into comedy as a kid, no one was into comedy. There wasn't even like a guy to talk to about Saturday Night Live or Monty Python. Mm-hmm. I felt like alone with this weird interest.
Yeah.
And only when I moved to Los Angeles and went to college and met the comedians at the Comedy Store and the Improv did I go, oh, so there's like hundreds of people who like everything that I like, that want to talk about it all night long. I always thought it felt like the Blind Melon video with the B-girl. Like, that's what coming to Los Angeles was like for me. Like, oh, I wasn't wrong to like all this stuff. And what, did you have that experience getting into the music scene, or did that ever happen for you?
I was playing this friend of mine at Kinks. There was like five of us, and playing a Kinks record, and I was like, yeah, see the guitar tone of that distortion, and see the space in between, and he's like, the drum sound and the snare, see how that goes off beat with the, he's like, you know, people, you know, some people don't listen to music like you. Some people just like listen to it to kind of enjoy it. He's basically telling me, shut the fuck up.
Oh, no.
You know, he's trying to just listen. But it was just always that way with me. And I think eventually you find that. And then certainly with this group of guys, you know, we can, you know, after a show, if we have a night and we have to travel or, and we, you know, we're still kind of up and awake and sitting in a confined space talking, and we can talk all night about music, and you know, we'll talk till we get to the next place at 3 a.m. or whatever, just laughing hysterically, remembering this, or oh yeah, so and so produced this, and then you realize like how fortunate you are, and how involved everybody is to this day, and you know, the passion for music is, you know, it's as strong as it was when we were naive little kids, and it seemed like the most exciting thing in the world. But so, you know, as you say, that do you find those people? Not only do you find them, but we got to be in a group together. So
yes,
it all worked out.
And how is it? Like, I feel like a lot of our comedy friends, like, there's like a moment where you realize like certain friends have figured out their mental state, and some of them have kind of calmed down and centered and evolved, and other people kind of spin out. And that we're all almost in a post-success mode of like, why are we, because in the beginning you kind of do it because you're crazy. Like you're angry, you're trying to show somebody, low self-esteem, and it, like as a comedian you go on stage because you so desperately want approval, you're kind of willing to risk rejection by hundreds of people who could hate you at a comedy club. Hmm. But at some point that kind of goes away, and then you start creating for a different reason. Did you have an experience like that?
Yeah, I guess you end up, I just try to always remember that, you know, where that initial spark came from, and like a pilot light, and try to make sure that thing doesn't go out.
Yeah.
'Cause there's a purity to that. There's the, And probably that's where most people that listen to the records are still coming from.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you know, I suppose some of it, you know, I'm sure some listeners are also in a post-success mode, you know, or they've got families now, and they've kind of grown up with the group, and still find things of merit in the music. And not only that, but they followed us from early on, so they still like to hear what's coming next, I guess, from us. But I think like I think I'd try to remain conscious of that early, you know, the core nucleus of why you got into this for the first place, or that energy or whatever. And really the songs kind of dictate, you know, if the song is something like, you know, Mind Your Manners or Father Son that has that certain kind of edge to it, then it's like, bam, you can just go right to that place and it comes out pretty easy. You know, music or art, whether it's a painting, whatever it is, a set of lyrics, it just helps you process and keep the water pure, you know, you're just kind of putting it out and turning it into something, you know, hopefully worthwhile that other people can kind of experience the same, or, you know, people that have experienced the same emotions, they can again share in that and not feel like they were the only ones.
Who were your drum heroes, original drum heroes?
My dad took me to go see Buddy Rich when I was about 13. It's like my first, or 12, when it was my first concert. And he took me to go see Count Basie, so jazz drummers were kind of blew my mind initially. But then I got into, like, you know, Cheap Trick and Deep Purple and huge Hendrix fan. So, like, all those drummers were just fantastic.
There's a scene in Freaks and Geeks where Joe Flaherty plays Buddy Rich for Jason Segel to show him what a real drummer sounds like. He's like, here's a real drummer.
Does he doesn't go into the Buddy Rich tape dialogue, does he?
There's no clams.
There's no clams.
And who were your guitar heroes at the beginning?
You know, the 70s. Yeah. I started playing guitar when I was 11, and so I was, you know, the main reason I started playing music, hands down, no matter any other reason, was Kiss. That was it. I was a Cub Scout. And I was just doing all my things, playing soccer, and then I saw Kiss one day somewhere, like on a lunchbox, and I went home and I had a conversation with my dad and said, I don't want to do this anymore. I want to do this. And so they were the catalyst, you know, maybe Ace Frehley, and then certainly Hendrix being from Seattle and
Stones. How good was Ace Frehley?
He was great.
He's really great.
He's great.
Understated. He bends notes. He's very, very
He's a strong soulful. Player.
Yeah.
So you're still a part of the Kiss Army.
I am still there, yeah. I have given them a lot of money.
I remember I had the comic book that was made with real Kiss blood.
Yes,
that's right. I had one.
Did you watch the Kiss at the amusement park?
Only 100 times, yeah. I've seen that so many times that I'm just embarrassed to admit it. But so they were big.
Were you an Eddie Van Halen?
Yeah, I saw Van Halen, and I saw them 3 times in Seattle back in the day. And then he was... Recently, I've been trying to figure out Eruption just to, as a test, to see if I can actually do it.
And I'm just now you.
Now. Yeah. Now, and because I kind of got, I learned how to play like that for a while in the early '80s, and then I went, I'm not into this anymore. I got worn into blues.
Yeah.
So I kind of threw it away, but I've wanted to just test myself to see if I can actually do it, and I can now.
Yeah.
But when he came out, I was 11, and it felt like this guy's from another planet. I don't know what is going on here. I love it, but it didn't register in my head. Ace Frehley was more.
Yeah.
You could almost, and Angus Young, you could almost feel those easier than.
Dude, there's a YouTube video of this like 12-year-old girl playing Eruption flawlessly, and she's totally bored.
She's totally bored. That's fascinating to me because when I started, I was 11, and now there are kids that are starting when they're 5 and 4, and they're really good.
Yeah. When did you know that you could write and improvise on the guitar? But that's the big leap.
If you don't have that skill, then
I think it's just from years of playing in bands. Just you learn that from just playing with other musicians, and it had to be when I was 15 or 16, or you know, when I wrote some of my first songs. And my old metal band Shadow, that's how we learned. I learned how to communicate with other musicians and how to play off them, how to fight with them, how to not fight with them, how to all that and. I think just from years of practicing, that kind of improvisation came.
What songs on the new record are you especially proud of for your work?
I love Sirens. I'm very proud of that.
Which you wrote?
Yeah. I mean, if that's what you're asking, what I wrote, for sure, I'm very sorry for that. That feels like maybe a high watermark for me in terms of songwriting and feeling proud about it. Brendan O'Brien did a lot of arranging on it too. And
there's also that great, blues stomp one.
Oh yeah, Stone wrote that. Let the Records Play.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a great one too.
That's a cool. Stone has that crazy guitar, weird intro that was very intriguing the first time I remember hearing that.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Because I was thinking that for that kind of blues. You guys don't have that many songs that feel like old traditional kind of blues.
Because I don't see us ever kind of write. It was interesting that Stone did that because he generally veers away from that type of songwriting. And when I heard it, I was like, wow, I want to try to sound like Jeff Beck on this. That was my thought process. I'm going to try to get his tone. Mm-hmm. And I had just seen him about 2 or 3 months ago, and I was just like, I still don't understand what I saw, but he was so good.
We're the kings.
But,
we normally mock the blues.
Yeah.
So it's fun. It's funny that we actually try to play that type of groove, you know?
I mock it reverentially in terms,
of course.
You know, like being a white kid from Laurelhurst, you know, the middle class.
You've earned the blues.
But Matt's right. It is kind of, we never go into that territory, really.
What's it like when you write a song and Eddie writes lyrics to them, and do you feel like when it really works, is there the magic to, that's kind of the feeling I had that I, what is that experience like, that collaboration?
When it works better than any other situation I've ever been in terms of creativeness, and getting to play with the band and having Ed being passionate about a song and writing some lyrics that mean something to him, it just makes me happy. It's like, it's probably like, you know, writing a really great movie. It's the same thing, but on a smaller package.
Yeah, it's like on that song Sirens that Mike mentioned, there's a certain emotive power to just the chord structure and the way that dynamically the song works, and the lyrics and vocal performance like just made those aspects, you know, go through the roof. Mm-hmm. So
he makes it happen.
Yeah,
you know? and that like Matt said, it's very poignant what he's singing about, and you can feel it, and he's very serious about it, and I feel it on all the songs he's into.
Yeah.
He takes it all the way.
He's screaming on a few songs on this yeah. one too. Mm-hmm. So like he's brought back the scream.
The punk songs on the record.
Yeah.
And a lot of political songs, it seems.
Yeah.
You're all having, you know, it's just with all my comedy friends too, where suddenly everyone's getting married,
yeah.
and suddenly some of us are having kids, and we're all, like, you know, tracking that in our work.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how can you not, right?
Yeah.
That's the life that you're living at this point, and all that stuff does inform your art, so. It's nice that we're all sort of in pretty much the same boat. Mm-hmm. As
Those
far
are the
as
things
that, goes.
That matter now.
Yeah.
You know, when you're in your early 20s, none of that matters. You know, it's all about me, or just going on the road and whatever. But now it's.
How do you look back on that? Just that youthful, just insane hunger to break through.
I'm glad I'm not doing it anymore.
Yeah.
I'm so glad it broke.
It's kind of a mad.
So grateful I not have don't have to go through that.
Different person for sure.
Yeah. Because I think and I don't know if it's just like your testosterone in your 20s, but you're just like a crazy person when you have that determination to be heard, and just the amount of work you'll put in and how you just kill people for it.
But at the time, you're not really thinking in those terms, you know?
Yeah.
It just feels like a natural endeavor that you're on, you know? Like a natural sort of path that just feels right. Since we've all sort of gone through that hunger phase, it's like you just have to maybe channel that into where you are now in a different way, or I don't know.
It becomes, I think, almost later in life, pure creativity.
Yeah.
Because
you're
kind of not as insane.
Yeah.
And you're more reflective about
and
things.
Less playing the game, maybe.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
When you look back at it, are you so happy that you did stop chasing it so hard, and it feels like it's affected just the longevity of just people's interests. Like I have friends and they make movies, and I'll think, you know, you shouldn't star in 3 movies a year because your pace is wrong, and then you have to promote it 3 times a year, but people get hot and they just kind of want to jump on their moment, and then they naturally have to slow down at some point. But is that how you guys interpret the fallout of just taking a different path than other people who are just kind of trying to go at 10? Without ever stopping?
I think that following Ed's kind of initial inclination, and Stone and Jeff and them wanting to pull back early on for the first, if you're talking about kind of the first record when we blew up and we decided to not do videos anymore and do everything kind of the wrong model that the label was very much against us doing, but yet we survived through that and because of it, I think I'm very proud that they had that inclination, because that wasn't my thought process. I was like, let's do this. This is our chance. Let's do what we can do. Yeah. I'm not working as a prep cook anymore, and I'm on the road with the rock band.
But then you do think like, oh, there's only like 3 great Foreigner albums. Like all these bands did kind of explode, and kind of there's very few of them that were able to find some sort of pace and relationship with the audience that allowed them to have like the career over their entire lives, basically. Right.
And I think and there was a lot of luck in there too with us in this situation, you know, whether turning into when Matt was available, when we were going to go on that tour and he could learn 80 songs in 2 weeks, and luckily that turned into him being in the band. And there's a lot of things that happen that you kind of don't have control over too, that they're kind of fate oriented, I guess, too, along with pulling back. I don't know.
Yeah. From just your whole career, is like, are there certain shows like with other bands that are like your most memorable nights? that you like when you think like, oh, the time we got to open up for the Stones or U2, or just what are the ones that stick out for you? What's the first stories you would tell somebody or tell your kids?
I would say for me, getting to open up for the Stones, you know, they're probably my favorite band ever, and that, or getting to open up for the Who, or getting to open up for these bands that you grew up with that were these iconic bands, and getting to be part of that world for a second. Those two, Stones or the Who, were pretty exciting for me.
So, yeah, when did you guys start avoiding the group interview? Did you do them in the beginning, like the five-man interview?
Might have been around the time I stopped bathing. Can you feel how it's not?
I can feel it.
It's kind of like, whoa, group interview, it's different.
It's a whole different dynamic. It's like getting a whole cast of a movie together in one room. Like anything can happen. You were playing where in South America for the first time?
Mexico City is probably the first.
Is that strange, like going to like very foreign places where they're really into it and don't speak English? All I know is from like comedies where they'll dub them, and then you watch, and the jokes have all been changed, and the voices are changed, and it doesn't even feel like the movie. And but how is it for you with a totally foreign crowd?
Well, I'll never forget playing Istanbul the first time we played, or maybe the only time we played Istanbul, and just seeing all these people singing probably phonetically.
Yeah.
But singing along with a great intensity and passion, and I thought it was really one of those moments where you were kind of wondering, how did we get here?
Yeah. What are your guys' favorite comedy movies? Like when you're on the road and you have to fill your time.
Stones is Year One.
Oh, I've already talked to him about
that. Year One, we've beaten that one to death.
Which has all become our favorite, too.
Yeah. Really? Year One has gotten deep into the Pearl Jam bus?
Yeah, you never know when those ones are just going to resonate with you, but that one just...
What's your favorite section of Year One?
Man, we've got it mapped out.
Oliver Platt, the oil, and rub the lotion or die. Oh,
geez. And then the...
The police is...
Hank Azaria is just so beyond great, too, so there's a lot of little moments.
The tip.
Rock bands need comedy movies.
Yeah.
Like you're spending a lot of time in hotels and buses.
It's very important.
I always feel like there's like a kinship that we're kind of providing you with something to do.
The will to go on.
Exactly. I remember we were trying to clear a song for Freaks and Geeks, and we sent the episode to Neil Young, and then we heard he was watching it on the bus of the Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young tour. Like, oh my God, he's on a bus. What was it like touring with Neil Young? Like, what did you take from that experience afterwards?
For me personally, that's probably got to be the most influential sort of, you know, character that we've been able to kind of play music with or get close, just because his depth is so great, and just watching him and how long he's been around and the variety of songs and the simplicity which he plays and the fact that he's like this, you know, amazing singer and this lead player and all the variations that he's done and all the chances he's taken and all the, you know, all his ups and downs and all that stuff has just inspired us to kind of, inspired me for sure, and I know the rest of the band, just to like be like, okay, you know, what would Neil do? You know, what?
And he just doesn't give a fuck.
Why doesn't he give a fuck?
The muse is the whole deal.
How did that happen?
Awesome. He's getting closer and closer to the core at all times, you know. And it's his own journey, and he just doesn't care what anybody else thinks about, you know, what direction he should take, because he's tuned into something that he won't even take the time to explain to anybody else. He's on to something pretty much at all times. He's usually on to about three or four things at once.
Because he was on the American Masters, and they were asking him about making records and records that don't sell because you're experimenting, and they asked him if he felt bad that a record didn't sell, and he said, no, I always feel like I got another one through. I tricked him again. I was able to do a new thing, and I got it made. And it's just, you know, it's so the reverse of how most people think about what they do. I mean, I know just as a comedy writer, I've watched that interview and thought, okay, I gotta have the balls to just say what I want to say and not worry, you know, if I'm gonna take a hit on it. And maybe that's why I'll connect with an audience, because it's getting more pure, because I'm not trying to figure them out every moment.
I remember the first time we went to his ranch, and we were in a room playing, and he came in and strapped on a guitar and just started playing the weirdest stuff. It was like, what is he doing? And then all of a sudden, he made his thing work with these two chords that we were kind of playing. And I remember thinking, like, he's the most uninhibited, like, pure guy that I've ever been around. Like finding that weird thing that actually made our jam special.
And do you feel like you take those lessons into the studio? Like, has any of that actually become part of, you know, the many things you've learned from
simplicity.
These people?
I mean, it's like every record, it's not like he's not getting more ornate. He's not getting adding more on. He keeps taking away more, you know, getting it down to more a simplistic version, which is a great place to aim for, because it just, you keep working with these real simple building blocks, and you can make these shapes with it that you just have to make them balanced. And he just does it in a way that inspires you to not come up with too busy of a part, or don't need, if somebody's already doing something, do something simpler than what somebody else is doing, or,
yeah.
You know.
I'm very much into, you know, hearing people's feedback, because comedy doesn't work if people aren't laughing, so that's part of our process. If I have a rough cut of a movie, I'll ask Cameron Crowe to come and a bunch of other filmmakers, and they'll give me notes and tell me what they would do, and then you just take what you like from it. Is that kind of what, like, Brendan does with you?
Well, one thing, we're lucky the records don't cost as much as films, because then we don't have as many people to... Well, it doesn't really have to go through any filters. It's kind of what we put out. It's just really, here's the five filters right here, and then Brendan would be the sixth, of which he's kind of a double filter. But, you know, and he kind of just kind of leads us through the process, and he works really quick, and over the years he just seems to work, you know, quicker and quicker. And in this process, you know, there were certain times we'd get the basic tracks for structure, and then I'd be kind of doing vocals in one room, and then they'd maybe overdubbing or changing some melodic things in this room, and then, you know, and it was happening like that for 10 days. I think there was only about two 10-day periods where we were really recording. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of at the end of both of those, before we got any rough mixes back, we all were kind of wondering, like, what happened? Did you hear anything, or did we?
Because there's 48 tracks, so even the rough mix, you might have put stuff down that's not in there, or something down that's you didn't hear before, and could have been an edit, or, you know, there's all kinds, so you don't know what you have, you know.
And the good thing about it was galvanizing that we all felt that way. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like one person knew. Yeah. And the others didn't, or one person was controlling it, and the other was just kind of. I liked that part of it too. I felt like it. His process, it actually, in a way, kind of made us come together a little bit, because we all had the same concerns.
And we had meetings about that on the road. We sat down and talked with all five of us for hours.
And Brendan's really strong-willed, but he's also flexible. I mean, there'll be songs where Brendan's like, I don't think we should work on that song. That doesn't seem like a good song. Well, we're going to work on it. Well, I don't think we should work on it. Oh, we're going to work on it. We work on it, and then it turns into a great song. So even he is misjudging things and sort of not quite... he's still in the... he's one of us, for sure, in terms of, like, all of us will have our... You know, you kind of want to pick your fights a little bit in terms of, like, what are you concerned about? Or if there's a song that something's not working, you kind of got to know when to talk about it and when not to. But... and he's in that process with us. I mean, he was, you know, proved wrong a couple times on this record, and I think all of us were in different ways about certain songs that either we thought were great that didn't end up being great, or ones that were great, or whatever. And at the end, I think the filter process really worked. I think when I listen to those 11 songs now, I'm like, I feel great about everything that was taken away and everything that was added on. You know, it seems like the right amount of, you know, it still seems stripped down, but it seems really tight, too.
How long does it take for you guys to know what you did after you finish a record? I mean, like, for a movie, sometimes for years, you're not, you know, like, I could go look at Funny People right now and have a completely different perspective on, you know, sometimes I'll watch an old movie we made and just go, that movie's crazy. What were we thinking, you know? Or, you know, I just go, oh, that was so much darker than I thought at the time. I was really giggling, but I can see why people were scared of that. What's it like with an album?
I think that we all were in the trenches with the record when we were making it, and then, you know, lyrically, and then hashing it out and getting it across the finish line and taking in all these you know, it's a real kind of intense process, but it's constant listening. You're listening when you're doing other things, you know. You're listening when you're cooking or eating, you know, like people are talking to you and you're listening to the, you know, I hate to say it, but sometimes you're still just trying to, it's just this big puzzle that you feel like you have to be, always have like a finger on it, so you can kind of.
What's it like having a big catalog of songs you're proud of? And like, can you believe you have that many songs to choose from when you're doing a set list? Like, does it become a pain? Like, I think we got too many now to figure this out.
I always go back to that first album tour. Like, we were on the road for a year and a half and probably played 150 shows or 200 shows or something. And just how frustrating it was, like.
Having 41 minutes of material?
Well, 12 songs to choose from.
But we played our set, and we had two or three covers, and we had maybe a couple new tunes. We were always looking forward to this day. Yeah, you know, which is its own bear.
Because when I went to the sound check, someone came up and they had a list of every song you ever recorded, and they said, "Oh, is there anything you want them to see if they want to play tonight?" And I just couldn't believe how long it was. Yeah. I mean,
page 3.
Yeah, exactly. Wow, there's a lot of stuff there.
Did you ask for Light Years?
I asked for a wish list.
Wish list.
I'll cry during a Pearl Jam song. Do you find that like people like? I always wonder if like, because not even just like a ballad. Like there's something about like a lot of the songs that kind of take me to like the crying place. Is it just me? Mm-hmm.
No, we've definitely seen some criers out there.
Yeah.
Male and female.
What are we crying about?
Shared emotional experience, I don't know. Like sometimes music is able to hit that spot that the other art forms don't hit as quickly. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like there's some shared thing going on there that I can't always get from a painting or sometimes a movie, yeah, will hit hard, like Marley and Me. I mean, it's like, I've never really cried before.
That's what
a movie.
I was trying to say, that your songs are like Marley and Me.
He's about to bust up right
and
now.
I tell
just
you.
When you just say Marley and Me, it's just like.
Not even when the dog dies, just all of it.
It's just crazy.
Off He Goes always makes me cry. Yeah. Off He Goes for some reason.
Wow.
I don't know if that's just about my own workaholism or, but it. There's something about it. Like as soon as it starts, I'm kind of gone.
I think an attributing factor too could be what the person was going through at the time that they heard it.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Totally. Or at the time that they were listening to, because it's almost music at that point. They say that you know the sense of smell is the most powerful of the senses, but of the five senses, I mean, you could include hearing, but the music is like another one. Mm-hmm. And I think it can bring you back. There's certain songs that I can hear, and I can like, I know it was in my pocket when I was 8 years old, mm-hmm. and I can see the ground moving underneath the pedals of my bike, going to so and so's house to get in trouble. But I think it's just it has the potential of doing that. So I'm thinking that usually it's people, you know, they're hearkening back to the way they were feeling at that time, whether it was like in love or having lost somebody or you know, any of those emotions, could be one of joy or whatever. I mean, I actually, you know, I was at a Bruce Springsteen concert and I was weeping openly. And the reason I was weeping, because they had a nice screen at Wrigley Field behind and they were showing the crowd. Mm-hmm. And I was watching all these other people weeping. Of joy, like Born to Run and like crying. It was raining, but you could still see tears through the rain. It was all this thing. And I gladly lost it and let it go and felt great. It was like this purging or like a ritualistic experience.
What songs are you excited to play when you start touring from the new record? Is there anything that you...
All of them.
I'd play anything.
Yeah, I'm excited to see. I mean, you kind of don't know what's going to work great and what's maybe not going to work as great initially. And again, that thing that doesn't work great initially, in 5 years, it'll probably be like our favorite thing, you know?
So. I think these ones are going to work good for a long time.
Yeah.
You know?
They're well built. They're sort of constructed well. They're simple and straightforward for the most part. And
your fans are so like hungry and they're so excited for all of the new stuff.
We're real lucky.
Yeah.
I mean, for sure, to have that sort of response.